Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us. We're going to pick it up today. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 6. And things are not going well in the 10 tribes to the north, which became known as Israel. King after king after king, and each one kept doing worse than all of the kings before, as far as leading the people into idolatry, leading the people away from God. In our last lecture, we came to Ahab, the husband to Jezebel, and Ahab, well, Elijah was introduced to us in our last lecture as well. And Elijah had told the people of Israel, it's not going to rain until I say so. In other words, until the Lord says so, in that he was a prophet of the Lord. 3.5 years, no rain, not even so much as a drop of dew on the land. And I'll tell you what, there's a famine, a sore famine in the land. And, you know, Ahab, what did we find him doing as we ended our last lecture? Well, he had a governor of his house, Obadiah, who was a man of God. He feared and revered the Lord. In fact, when Jezebel started killing prophets of the Lord, true prophets of the Lord, Obadiah hid 100 of them in a cave and was making sure that they had something to eat and water. But Ahab called Obadiah and he said, well, look, we got to make a run for it and try and find some water and some pasture before we lose all of our animals. And so he told Obadiah, you go that way, I'm going to go this way. And you see, Ahab had been looking for Elijah for over 3 years. They searched almost every nation in the world, and then made the leaders of the nation take an oath that they hadn't seen Elijah, and if they did, they would haste to let Ahab know. But you see, Ahab's running around looking for some water and a little bit of pasture so that he doesn't lose all of his animals. What he should be looking for is the Lord. And the kings of Israel just didn't get it. It looks like they would have said, you know, what is causing all this trouble to come our way? When did it start? Well, it started when Jeroboam made the two golden calves and started appointing his own priests and made a holiday, a festival, a feast day in the 8th month, which wasn't appointed by God. So just didn't get it. And that's what God is trying to do, is get their attention, the people of Israel. Well, will he have gotten their attention with 3.5 years of no rain? Let's ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day as we pick it up. 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 6. So they, this is Ahab and Obadiah, divided the land between them to pass throughout it. They could cover more ground if one went one way and one went the other. Ahab went one way by himself, and Obadiah went another way by himself. Verse 7, and as Obadiah was in the way, behold, Elijah met him, and he knew him. He recognized Elijah, and fell on his face and said, art thou that my Lord Elijah? Question. And he knew it was Elijah. He can't believe his own eyes, and he's wanting to verify, you are Elijah, right? Verse 8, and he answered him, I am, go tell thy Lord, referring to Ahab, note the small L, behold, Elijah is here. Now, Ahab will undoubtedly think that this is good news. Will Obadiah think that it's good news? And he, Obadiah, said, what have I sinned that thou wouldest deliver thy servant unto the hand of Ahab to slay me? Here we see Obadiah is fearful. And he's probably thinking, you know, we've been looking for Elijah for 3.5 years. Ahab is probably going to be thinking that I'm hiding Elijah in a cave somewhere from him as well. And if I go tell him, behold, Elijah is here, and then Elijah, the Spirit of the Lord, tells you to go somewhere else and disappear for another 3.5 years, Ahab's not going to think it's funny. In fact, is my head will probably roll. Verse 10, as the Lord thy God liveth, this is an oath, the most serious oath you can take, there is no nation or kingdom whither my Lord, this is Ahab, hath not sent to seek thee, in reference to Elijah. And when they said, he is not here or there, he took an oath of the kingdom and nation that they found thee not. He made them swear that they hadn't seen you, and likely made them swear if they did see you, they would summons him first thing. We've searched the whole world for you. It's too bad that Ahab didn't get it and search for the Lord. You seek him and he will be found of you. Forsake him and he will forsake you. Verse 11. Now thou sayest, go tell thy Lord, behold, Elijah is here. Are you sure that's what you want me to do? And again, I think you're trying to get me killed, Elijah. Verse 12. And it shall come to pass, as soon as I am gone from thee, that the Spirit of the Lord shall carry thee whither I know not. And so when I come and tell Ahab, and he cannot find thee, he shall slay me. But I, thy servant, fear the Lord from my youth. I have revered the Lord since my youth. And you've been gone for 3.5 years, and now you want me to go tell Ahab Elijah's here. Verse 13. Was it not told, my Lord, wasn't Ahab told, what I did when Jezebel slew the prophets of the Lord? She was trying to exterminate the worship of Yahweh for Baal worship. How I hid 100 men of the Lord's prophets by 50 in a cave and fed them with bread and water. Jezebel doesn't know about it, but Ahab knows that I hid 100 of the Lord's prophets to save their life. Ahab is certainly not going to feel like he owes me any great favors. Verse 14. And now thou sayest, go tell thy Lord, in reference to Ahab, behold, Elijah is here, and he shall slay me. Again, he might think that I've been hiding you in a cave like I've been hiding the other hundred prophets of the Lord. Verse 15. And Elijah said, as the Lord of hosts liveth, again, this is an oath, before whom I stand, or I serve, you could translate, I will surely show myself unto him today. And verse 1, that's what the Lord instructed Elijah, go show thyself unto Ahab. So he's assuring, doing the best he can to assure Obadiah that it is his full intent and God isn't going to change his mind, and the Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, caused Elijah to disappear. I am going to show myself to Ahab. The Lord instructed me to do it, and that's what I will do. Verse 16. So Obadiah went to meet Ahab, and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. It got Ahab's attention. And again, Ahab's likely thinking this is very good news, that the rains will finally come. I mean, it's dry. 3.5 years, can you imagine, with not even so much as a drop of dew? Verse 17, and it came to pass, when Ahab saw Elijah, that Ahab said unto him, art thou he that troubleth Israel? I'll bet that went all over Elijah. It wasn't Elijah who was troubling Israel. It was Ahab and Jezebel building a house for Baal in Samaria, the capital of the 10 tribes to the north. Jezebel killing the prophets, the true prophets of the Lord, and promoting 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the groves, as we'll see in the next few verses. Elijah knew full well who was the cause of the trouble that had come upon Israel. And it wasn't just Ahab, it was the entire nation. Yeah, Ahab was not setting a good example. Jezebel was not setting a good example, but the people were following. The people were practicing idolatry. They brought the trouble upon themselves. Verse 18, and he answered, I have not troubled Israel, Elijah speaking to Ahab, but thou and thy father's house, in that ye have forsaken the commandments of the Lord, and thou hast followed Balaam. And that is the truth. That's the reason that there has been no rain. You see, Elijah was fully aware of what Leviticus chapter 26, verse 19 states, that if you don't do things God's way, which Israel had not been doing things God's way, God said, I'll make your heaven as iron and your earth as brass. That means I'll make your ground as hard as brass. Have you ever tried to plow brass or ground that's that hard? You're not going to get very far. And if you do get a seed, manage to get a seed in the ground, it's certainly not going to germinate because there's no water, no moisture to cause the seed to germinate. Verse 19. Now therefore send and gather me all Israel unto Mount Carmel, and the prophets of Baal, 450, and the prophets of the groves, 400, which eat at Jezebel's table. Eating at the queen's table means that she is maintaining them, providing them with food and shelter. 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the groves, or vice versa. And my goodness, you know, they've been busy, Jezebel and Ahab. By the way, Carmel means pleasant or a fruitful place. It sits on an elevation above the area around it, some 1,800 feet above water level. And it had a cistern on top of it that was basically fed by underground springs. And the reason I'm explaining that is because there's going to be a lot of water available here to Elijah when he calls for it. And with the drought that had been there, I didn't want that to sound funny or confuse you. Verse 20. So Ahab sent unto all the children of Israel, and gathered the prophets together unto Mount Carmel, 850 prophets of Baal and the groves. And Elijah is calling all the people of Israel, representatives at least, of all the people of Israel, because he wants them to witness what is about to happen. You see, the spirit of Elijah is to return the hearts of the children back to the fathers, as it states in Malachi chapter 4, along about verses 5 and 6. God promised there that before the great and terrible day of the Lord, that's the second advent when Christ returns, I will send Elijah to return the hearts of the children back to the fathers. Well, Elijah is about to see if the people of Israel can be talked any sense into them, or if they want to continue worshiping Baal. Verse 21. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, how long halt ye between two opinions? This halt ye is to leap or limp. In opinions, you could think of thoughts. In other words, how long are you going to jump from one thought and then back to another? If the Lord be God, follow him. Worship the Lord if he is God. But if Baal, then follow him. And the people answered him not a word. They didn't have anything to say. And, you know, these double thinkers, he's telling them, make up your mind. If Yahweh is the God, worship him. But don't think that you can worship him one day, and then the next day you're worshiping Baal. And people say, well, you know, we wouldn't do that today. Oh, well, on what's supposed to be the high Sabbath of the year, the Passover, they're following religions that have them being quick like the rabbit, the Easter bunny, Ishtar bunny, I'll say, the Phoenician goddess of love and fertility, out rolling eggs in the groves. James chapter 1, verse 8, it states that in the New Testament that a double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. You can't count on them. You know, when one day they're thinking this way, the next day they're thinking another way. It's called double-minded. God sure can't use somebody like that. Why? Because he can't count on them. Verse 22. Then said Elijah unto the people, I, even I only, remain a prophet of the Lord, but Baal's prophets are 450 men. Elijah is about to propose a little contest to see whose God is real. Verse 23, let them, referring to the 450 Baal prophets, therefore give us two bullocks, and let them choose one bullock for themselves and cut it in pieces and lay it on the wood. Let them prepare the one bullock for the sacrifice, and put no fire under, and I will dress the other bullock and lay it on wood and put no fire under it. Again, Elijah's proposing a little contest, and the conditions that he's laying down are making it to where it's so fair that there's no way that the Baal prophets, the 450, can refuse without losing face. 24, and call ye on the name of your God, small g, and I will call on the name of the Lord, Yahweh, and the God that answereth by fire, let him be God. And all the people answered and said, it is well spoken. Again, he had them. If they refused, the people of Israel there as witness would be going, I think I'm going with Elijah's God. Yahweh's way of accepting sacrifices has always been to accept them by fire. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29, our God is a consuming fire. Verse 25. And Elijah said unto the prophets of Baal, choose you one bullock for yourselves and dress it first. You take your pick of the bullocks so that somebody doesn't think, nobody can say that I pick the best one. You take your choice. For ye are many, 450, I'll say, and call on the name of your God, small g, but put no fire under. Verse 26, and they took the bullock which was given them, and they dressed it, and called on the name of Baal from morning even until noon, saying, O Baal, hear us. But there was no voice, nor any that answered. And they leaped upon the altar which was made. This is better stated, they leaped up and down before the altar. If they jumped up on the altar, they certainly weren't expecting any fire, obviously. But from morning until noon, half the day, they're calling on Baal, but nobody heard. I don't think there's anybody home. Verse 27. And it came to pass at noon that Elijah mocked them and said, Cry aloud, for he is a god, small g, according to you he is a god. Either he is talking, this is meditating to himself, or he is pursuing, or he is on a journey, or peradventure he sleepeth and must be awaked. Now, if you ever have a doubt that God has a sense of humor, this verse proves that our Father does have a sense of humor. You check out this word pursuing. It means that he has a pursuit, which is a figure of speech, meaning that it's potty break time. He's either on the head or he's looking for a head to use the restroom. And of course, our Heavenly Father never sleeps, but this is rich. Verse 28, they're not done yet. And they cried aloud. Maybe we need to cry a little. Maybe Elijah's right. We don't seem to be getting any response. Maybe we need to cry a little louder. And cut themselves after their manner, their heathenistic ways, with knives and lancets till the blood gushed out upon them. Maybe that Elijah's right. Maybe we need to shout louder and do more, like cut ourselves until we bleed with knives and lancets. Verse 29. And it came to pass when midday was past, and they prophesied until the time of the offering, this would be the normal evening sacrifice, of the evening sacrifice, that there was neither voice nor any to answer, nor any that regarded, no one paying attention. Again, I don't think anybody was home. Now, you see, the people, the representatives of Israel, have been there since early morning, taking all this in. And so I'm sure it was at first a little bit entertaining watching the Baal prophets jump up and down in front of the altar and then pricking themselves with knives until they bled. But all in all, it's been a pretty boring day. I mean, from morning until evening, and no fire has certainly come down. Verse 30, and Elijah said unto all the people of Israel, Come near unto me. And all the people came near unto him. And he repaired the altar of the Lord that was broken down. You come close and you watch carefully. You're about to witness the power of God. This altar that was there, Carmel, was probably someone's private or personal altar, and the Baal worshipers had torn it down. And Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes of Israel, according to the number of the tribes of the sons of Jacob, unto whom the word of the Lord came, saying, Israel shall be thy name. Genesis chapter 32, verse 28, when Jacob wrestled with the angel of the Lord and prevailed over him. God changed his name to Israel. If you translate it rather than transliterate it, it means prince that prevails with God. 32, and with the stones he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he made a trench about the altar as great as would contain 2 measures of seed. This would be a trench about 3 feet wide. And he put the wood in order and cut the bullock in pieces and laid him on the wood and said, fill four barrels with water. No doubt these came from that cistern on Mount Carmel. And pour it on the burnt sacrifice and on the wood and wet it down real good. And the fire they were about to see will consume even the water. Verse 34, and he said, do it the second time. And they did it the second time. And he said, do it a third time. And they did it a third time. 12 barrels of water in all. I think Elijah showing Israel water is about to become abundant once again. The water shortage is about over. And the water ran or went round about the altar, and he filled the trench also with water. And it came to pass at the time of the offering of the evening sacrifice, the daily sacrifice, there was one in the morning, one in the evening, that Elijah the prophet came near and said, Lord God of Abraham, Isaac, and of Israel. I think that deliberate because of what was said in verse 31 rather than Jacob. Let it be known this day that thou art God in Israel, and that I am thy servant, and that I have done all these things at thy word. I'm not doing this of my own mind or my own heart. I'm following your instructions, Father. 37, hear me, O Lord, hear me, that this people may know that thou art the Lord God, and that thou hast turned their heart back again. The purpose of Elijah, to turn the heart of the children back to the Father, with the capital F. The purpose of this and all other miracles, to let people know that our Heavenly Father is the God of heaven and earth. Verse 38. Then the fire of the Lord fell and consumed the burnt sacrifice and the wood and the stones. Even the stones were consumed, and the dust, and licked up the water that was in the trench, all of it. Verse 39. And when all the people saw it, they fell on their faces, and they said, the Lord, that's Yahweh in the Hebrew, he is the God, the Lord, Yahweh again, he is God. They fell on their faces before the altar. Elijah did turn the hearts of the children back to the Father. And Elijah said unto them, take the prophets of Baal, let not one of them escape. And they took them, and Elijah brought them down to the brook Kishon and slew them there. And I can just hear it now, some bleeding heart Christian saying, well, that doesn't sound like a very good man of God. Yes, he was a very good man of God. He was taking care of business. God's law says that you will take false prophets and kill them, Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. And why would God want to kill all 450 of these prophets? Let not one of them escape. You see, God knows, and that a little bit of leaven can spread through the whole loaf, the teachings of Jesus Christ in the New Testament. What that means is, and he wasn't talking about the leaven that you put in bread. He's talking about the doctrine and false doctrine. A little bit can spread through your whole church if you're not careful. That's why God wanted it eliminated and stamped out completely. Verse 41, and Elijah said unto Ahab, get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain. And evidently, they probably hadn't eaten all day. 3.5 years had been without rain. And now Elijah says there is a sound of abundance of rain. So Ahab went up to eat and to drink, And Elijah went up to the top of Carmel. He cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees. He totally humbled himself, kneeling down and then placing his forehead on the ground. 43, Elijah speaking, and said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." This would be the Mediterranean Sea. And he went up and looked and said, "There is nothing." And he said, "Go again seven times." "There's not one cloud in the sky," Elijah's servant said after the first time. Elijah said, "Go look seven times." You know, the person that took over for Elisha, told Naaman, a general of the Assyrian army, to go dunk himself seven times in the River Jordan. And Naaman said, "What, the waters of the rivers of my homeland in Assyria are not as good as the Jordan?" And then he went and he was healed of his leprosy. Spiritual perfection in the number seven in biblical numerics. Verse 44. And it came to pass at the seventh time that he went to look for the clouds, that he, this being Elijah's servant, said, "Behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea, like a man's hand." And he said, "Go up, say unto Ahab, prepare thy chariot, and get thee down, that the rain stop thee not." It's going to rain for sure. And what this means, like a man's hand, if you were looking off into the horizon and you saw a cloud and you held your hand up and it was about the size of your hand at that distance, is what that's talking about. Of course, a chariot could become, you know, stuck in the mud easily, is what Elijah is instructing Ahab to get down from Mount Carmel before it starts raining. Verse 45. And it came to pass in the meanwhile that the heaven was black with clouds and wind, and there was a great rain, and Ahab rode and went to Jezreel. Verse 46 to conclude the chapter. And the hand of the Lord was on Elijah. Boy, was it on Elijah. And he girded up his loins and ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel, some 18 miles from Carmel to Jezreel. The hand of the Lord was on Elijah to perform these miracles. The Spirit of God was on Elijah. And Elijah accomplished a lot there. Turning the hearts of the children back to the Lord. Well, when Jezebel finds out that Elijah killed her prophets of Baal, she's not going to be happy about it. Don't miss our next lecture. We got a short message. Listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the mark of the beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, "Behold, I have foretold you all things." Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. Don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive format. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. If you're listening by shortwave radio or studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in being the point. Got a prayer request? We can do away with the telephone number. You don't need a telephone. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you continuously. I encourage you to talk to Him. And you know, you can talk to Him anywhere, anytime. You don't have to be in a special place or take a certain posture. You can talk to your Heavenly Father and approach Him at any time. I encourage you to do it. Make time each day to talk with your Heavenly Father. Let Him know that you love Him. You know, He is the closest relative that you have. Let Him know you love Him. And when you have major decisions in your life, it doesn't hurt to seek His counsel. You know, he does have your best interest at heart, especially if you're loving and serving Him. So take His counsel. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask You to look upon these. Father, You know their needs, sickness, illness, problem marriages. Father, You know, if it is Your will, a special blessing on each of these. Watch over, guide, direct, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank You, Father. All right, let's get to some questions, see what's on the mind of folks. First up today, we have Judy in Pennsylvania. Since it takes each member of any relationship to make it meaningful and successful, please explain what you mean when you say our relationship with God depends solely on us. Well, it's because we change, and our Heavenly Father never changes. He's the same yesterday, He's the same today, He will be the same tomorrow. So it is us who change. And if we, in our actions, we seek Him, then we find Him. That's biblical. If we forsake Him, then He will forsake us. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9 will document that. Janice, and we don't know where Janice is from, is there anything wrong or ungodly about wearing makeup and dressing nice? Well, you know, everything in moderation. In the Old Testament, prostitutes painted their face in a certain way, and it was a heavy makeup, if you would, and it actually it was paint at that time. But what they were doing by wearing such paint was advertising their wares. It was like putting a red light out in front of their tent, so to speak. So wearing makeup, and you know, you say dressing nice, I guess that's kind of a subjective decision as far as whether a dress is nice or not. But everything in moderation. Let's just leave it at that. Marion in Oklahoma. Where in the Bible are we given permission to ask the archangels to do anything? We aren't. In fact is, if you pray to the archangels or worship archangels, you're way in the wrong. Revelation chapter 22, verses 8 and 9 came to my mind with your question. And that's where when John was taken to the third heaven and in spirit. And after he had been shown all these things, chapter 22 of Revelation is the last chapter, if you're not familiar. But John fell down at the feet of the angel and started worshiping him. And the angel said, "See thou do it not," and raised him up. He said, I'm your fellow servant. So angels are fellow servants. They're not to be worshiped. Angel worship is a big taboo. Terry in California. Explain the first Earth Age and what kind of bodies did we have in the first Earth Age? Well, humans only had spiritual bodies in the first Earth Age. There was no womb for man at that period of time. There was no flesh man in the first Earth Age. That's what the second Earth Age was for. One third of God's children rebelled against him and followed Satan in the first Earth Age. And that's the reason that we have a second Earth Age, was God didn't want to destroy a third of his children, so he's given them a chance to follow him or follow Satan. You know, this understanding the three world ages is critical for your studies in God's Word. If you don't understand the three world ages, there's much of God's Word that you won't understand. Paul referred to it as the mysteries of God. On page 3 of every monthly newsletter that we send out, you'll find a list of suggested studies for new students, either cassette tape or CD being the format. And one of those on there is called Three World Ages, and CD number 30506. And if you don't understand the three world ages, I really recommend that you order that study. Again, it's critical for your understanding of God's Word in its entirety. Elizabeth in Kentucky, as we are studying 1 Kings, Solomon kept all the feast days, offering days. When did they stop having the offerings and all the feast days? Did they have it as long as the Ark of the Covenant was on earth? Well, you see, it wasn't the Ark of the Covenant that caused people to have feasts. God gave instructions for his children to celebrate these feast days in Leviticus chapter 23. And what caused them to cease the sacrifices in particular? Well, what caused that to happen, the event was the significance was the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus is referred to often as the Lamb of God. Part of the reason he's referred to as the Lamb of God is he was the Passover lamb that year. He was the sacrifice. But it would be an insult to God for us to offer animal sacrifice now. Give Hebrews chapter 9 a read, and you'll learn there that the blood of Jesus Christ covers our sins much more than the blood of an ox or the ashes of a red heifer. But we do continue to celebrate one feast day here at the chapel, but we don't do it with burnt offerings, obviously. The feast day that we keep, the Passover. Well, why do you keep Passover and you're Christian? 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, we learn there that Jesus Christ became our Passover. Good question. Charles in Texas. I don't have anything to do with Easter, the eggs, etc., but we have a barbecue. Is it all right to participate in the barbecue, knowing in my heart that Easter is not of our Father? Well, nothing wrong with having a barbecue at any time, you know. And there's nothing wrong with having a big meal on Easter. Just don't participate in the heathenistic practices, such as rolling the Easter eggs, etc. Deborah from Oklahoma. I have RA, rheumatoid arthritis, for those of you that didn't know, so excuse my writing. You write quite well, actually. Compared to what some other folks send in. My question is, I know the Bible says honor your father and mother, My dad died when I was 13. I'm 62 now. My mom moved every few months. She would leave me with a man and travel with, oh no, she would leave with a man and travel with him because of his job. She left us on doorsteps with a note and didn't come back for months. I do not love her. I have no bond with her whatsoever. She gets mad over anything I say and doesn't speak to me for years. She's evil and backstabbing and hides behind the Bible. Will God punish me for not loving her? Well, honoring your mother and father isn't exactly the same as loving your mother and father. You know, if it weren't for your mother and father, though, Deborah, we wouldn't have you. So honor her for bringing you into the world. Now, you know, it sounds like she did you wrong, if what, you know, and I have no reason to doubt what you said is true, that she left you for months on end. And, you know, it's hard to trust somebody that does that to you. And, you know, but do the best you can to respect her, that, and again, realize that if it wasn't for her, you wouldn't be born. Alan in Ohio. Is there any connection between 1 Kings chapter 7, verse 14, and Genesis chapter 4, verse 22, and then you put in quotes, worker with knowledge in brass? And yes, I think you could make that connection, and rightly so. You know, in Genesis chapter 4, verse 22, it's referring to the descendants of Cain, which, of course, a descendant of Cain is known as a Kenite. And in 1 Kings chapter 7, verse 14, we were talking about Hiram, who was the son of a man of Tyre. And you see, Tyre was a trading center. There was a lot of money that changed hands on Tyre. And if you know Kenites, you know that any place that money is changing hands, you're going to find Kenites there. So yeah, I think, you know, that would probably be a pretty safe connection to make, that Hiram was likely a descendant of Cain. It's not written, but if you put the pieces of the puzzle together, I think it fits. Jeff in South Carolina, is shrimp unclean and are catfish unclean? Both are unclean, and that's probably the unclean food that I have the biggest weakness for, is shrimp. I don't eat it all that often, but when I go down to the Gulf Coast to get away for a little R&R, those old Gulf shrimp sure call me then. Both are unclean, though, and in Leviticus chapter 11, verse 9, we learn that of what you take from the waters, what is clean, the determining factor of what is clean and unclean. To be clean, whatever comes from the waters must have fins and scales. Shrimp do not have scales nor fins, and catfish don't have scales, so they don't fit what is clean from the water. Catfish are bottom feeders. Whatever's on the bottom of the lake or pond or the river, that's what they eat. And what happens when other fish and creatures of the waters die? They go to the bottom. So they're scavengers, basically, and that's another reason that they eat garbage, and if you eat them, you're basically eating garbage. Mark in California, the two rainbows in Revelation, please explain. In Revelation chapter 6, verse 2, we have, well, and let me back up to verse 1, you've got one who arrives riding on a white horse. And then in verse 2, it states that he has a bow. I want you to check out that word bow in your Strong's Concordance, and you'll find that it's the Greek word toxon, and it means that it is a imitation. It's a cheap fabric imitation of the rainbow that you find in Revelation chapter 10, verse 1, which is the actual Shekinah glory of our Lord. So you got two bows, one is fake, one is real in Revelation. I did a Sunday message not too awfully long ago entitled The Bow. And it's an interesting study. The rainbow was chosen by our Heavenly Father as a sign that he would never flood the earth again after the flood of Noah's time. Teresa in Oklahoma, are the Irish people one of the 10 tribes that came across the mountains? Yes, most of people that are of Irish descent are descendants of those who the 10 tribes of Israel that were in bondage to the Assyrian, and then after 200 years they were released and they went north over the Caucasus Mountains, settling into Europe and many migrating on into the United States and Canada. The lost 10 tribes of Israel, and boy are they lost. Most of them haven't a clue who they are. Curtis in California, why isn't Christmas in the book of Leviticus? Well, I mentioned earlier that we're given the feast days of the Lord in Leviticus chapter 23. Of course, Christmas is not listed there yet because Christ hadn't been conceived or crucified at that point in time. Leviticus 23 was the old covenant, meaning we were in the dispensation at that point in time where they were under the law. And of course, now we fortunately live in the dispensation of grace under the new covenant. And Jesus Christ is the new covenant. Imogene in Kentucky, can you please explain the serpent seed? Well, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3 explains it pretty well. It states, and of course, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, Paul states, you know, I don't want you, I'm jealous over you, and I don't want you to be beguiled like Mother Eve was beguiled by the serpent in the garden. And I want you to take your Strong's Concordance and check out that word beguiled. You'll find that it's expateo, and it means wholly seduced. That's the only meaning for it, is it's wholly seduced. So what happened in the Garden of Eden? If you study it in the Hebrew, you can learn it in Genesis, but if you study it in the Hebrew, we know that the serpent seduced Eve, and they had relations, and a child was conceived. His name was Cain. That's the beginning of the serpent seed. Kurt from Kansas, if every soul on earth turned in for 1/2 hour lecture to your program, what book and chapter would you choose for your lesson? Thank you for your teaching truth from God's Word, and you're welcome, Kurt. You know, I used to say that this book or that chapter or this verse or that verse was my favorite in the whole Bible. I can't say that anymore. The whole Word is so rich and full if you understand it and if you study it with understanding. I can't choose. Larry from Illinois. My sister and I were talking Bible. She said the devil was on earth now, Revelation 12:9. I said all of Revelation is for the end of time, meaning all of Revelation is prophecy still to come. Well, I don't agree with you that Revelation is all of prophecy still to come. Some of it has already transpired. You're right, though, some of it is prophecy to come. But if your sister says Satan is here now, where is he? You know, oh yeah, his spirit is here, but I'm talking Satan de jure. In other words, Satan himself here on earth. He's going to be here on earth when Michael boots him out, and that's where you read about it, Revelation chapter 12, verse 6, and the following verses. But and you know, what's he going to be doing when he is here? Well, you can read about that in God's word as well. He's going to be pretending to be Jesus Christ. And as it states in Revelation chapter 13, the whole world is going to be deceived except those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. That's his election. Rebecca in Alabama, people around the world are saying they hear trumps. Any scriptures pertaining to that fact? Question, does it mean we are moving into a new age or our good Lord Jesus Christ is returning? God bless you. Thank you all at Shepherd's Chapel for your assistance. It's greatly appreciated, and you're welcome. You know, the labor pangs of a new age are growing closer and closer together. I'll just say, watch, watchman, watch. Out of time, I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying our Father's Word in depth. It makes his day. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. Help us keep coming to you and reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. One thing that's most important, though, beloved, and it's this. You stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. Do you know why? It's because Jesus, Yeshua, he is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645. 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
This has been a long time I've been promising a children's book. This is a book that will help a parent teach their child exactly what God's word states. Now, this was done by a very good friend and student of this chapel. We have given it, if you would, a binder whereby if there is a page that you feel is too far advanced for your children, then by all means you should remove that particular page. It is done in a material that is even washable, and it takes you step by step into instructing a child what does God's word say. And I think you will find it extremely helpful. It is item number 4414.
Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Arnold Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now here is Pastor Arnold Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Say welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. You know, one of the probably most asked questions that we receive has to do in or about tongues. So we're going to discuss tongues today. And being a teacher, there's only one way I know how to teach, and that is from the Word of God. At least, let me put it